like to welcome you to our talk about the introduction to the Open Service Broker API. My name is Tobias Placht. I'm working at QAware in Munich. I'm something between dev and ops, and unfortunately, since I've started working with Kubernetes, I've become some kind of YAML engineer. This is my colleague Nico from DGI in Cologne, and he's a cloud platform engineer. So let's start it with this very old Dilbert strip. I've seen it many times on various conferences, but unfortunately, 8 years later, it's still very relevant, and everybody's talking about cloud and platforms. And yeah, let's be honest. Kubernetes is a platform for building your platform, and let's be honest, who is the work developing his own Kubernetes platform for his developers? And only one? No? You're all using managed Kubernetes? Ah, OK. And lastly, one of my coworkers asked me, OK, we still have no platform. So where are all the platforms? I know there's Cloud Foundry and Heroku and a lot of other platforms, but we saw an open opportunity and decided to build with our colleagues a platform called Syncier Cloud, which is a platform for regulated enterprises. And our mission is to enable regulated enterprises to leverage cloud-native technology. So what does this mean? We have a platform with the three building blocks. The first and most important one is continuous delivery. In order to have a short time to market, you need a continuous delivery pipeline. There's a lot of movement in the continuous compliance section. There's a lot of work ongoing with policies, like, for example, the Open Policy Agent. And we are working on a tool called FileLake, where you can define your security policies inside a Git repository, and it's validated all the time. And if you take a look at the cloud-native landscape, there is a lot of cool technologies, but we have new technologies every week, and we are helping you to choose the right technology. In order to get a better feeling, let's take a look at the following picture. What we are offering is a Kubernetes on top of your infrastructure as a service provider of your choice. This could either be Google Cloud, Azure, AWS, VMware, you name it. And we are adding some additional values on top of this. This includes the continuous delivery toolchain, the site reliability engineering toolchain, billing, accounting, you name it. And our goal is to write your own platform-specific extensions. And we're going to focus on the service broker part. I don't know. I can see it. OK. So let's get one step back. It is very important to understand you can't go cloud native if you don't have proper CI and CD. This task alone is very difficult to achieve for most companies we are working with. And it's very easy if you are a startup. You can put all your stuff in GitHub, and you can use something like Travis or Circle CI or any of the other great services. But let's imagine for a short moment you are not some startup, you are a very regulated enterprise customer, like in the financial service or in the insurance company, and you must or you're subject to strict regulations. Just to give you a few examples, every deployed artifact must be available for 10 years. This includes the whole source code, the documentation, it must be versioned. And it can happen that some regulation company comes and asks, OK, 10 years ago, you calculated the value for my, I don't know the word, you calculated some value, show me how you did this. You need very fine-grade authentication and authorization, which is often backed by an LDAP directory, which is older than myself. It is absolutely mandatory to have an audit log where you can see who changed what, when, and why. There's something called for ICE principle, which makes it technically impossible to achieve continuous delivery, because you need at least two people to deploy an artifact into production. And there are, I believe, many, many more who I haven't heard before. So These regulations leading to a complex and highly opinionated tool chain. So for nearly every customer, we see something like a keycloak, which is federated across multiple identity providers. You have something like an Artifactory, where you store all your artifacts. You have Jenkins and several namespaces, which mimic some kind of staging and production environment. So this is one of the possible. This is one of the tool chains we want to provision. And of course, there is some stuff missing, like Grafana, Prometheus, your internal systems, and many more. And in the beginning, we started with plain Helm, which is an awesome tool, and some Bash magic. And to our surprise, it worked. At least for some time. This was a static configuration. It was nearly impossible to maintain. We had very long round trips times for testing, and we didn't like the strong dependency to Helm, because it is possible that Helm is no longer the option in the future, or something like Helm 3, which is completely incompatible with Helm 2. Yes, and it all collapsed when some other customer said, OK, I don't want to pay the Artifactory license. Is it possible to use something like Chart Museum and the Docker Registry for storing our artifacts? And then our 1,000 bash line script exploded. So we went back to the drawing board, and we came up with the following requirements, which we need to enable some kind of self-service and the possibility to get your stuff into the cluster. The first one is we need the possibility to support flexible deployment mechanisms. So Helm is currently the answer, but we won't get locked into Helm. We need to support complex deployment scenarios. As you've seen in the picture before, every tool must be connected to Keycloak for single sign-on. And it should be generic to deploy multiple services. And when we talk about services, this could be either a database, your application, or something like Jenkins. And in an ideal world, it would be based on existing open source standards. And this led us finally to the Open Service Broker API, which on the paper fulfills all our requirements. The promise in theory is very promising. It's an API specification for building service brokers. And each service broker provides different lifecycle methods for deploying and connected services. And each of these services is independent of the technology or the infrastructure. Just to give you an example of the available service broker right now, there's one very new from the Oracle Cloud Infrastructure, which was announced at the KubeCon in Barcelona. There's one for the Huawei Cloud. There's the Automation Broker, which is often called Ansible Service Broker from Red Hat. You have a service broker for Azure and AWS. There was a service broker for a Google Cloud Platform, which was deprecated 2 months ago. So they're switching to custom resource definition. And yes, so now you have your API, and you have multiple implementations, and you need some glue code between to get this running in Kubernetes. And this is called a service catalog. There's another implementation for Cloud Foundry. So you can run your brokers either on Cloud Foundry or Kubernetes. The service catalog is a Kubernetes special interest group. It's multiple years old and is an extension API, not a custom resource definition. And it's filling the gap between a Kubernetes cluster and multiple service brokers. So let's take a look at the whole picture. The user talks to the Kubernetes API servers using a client which is called SVCut, or there are some UIs available. The API server is an extension. Like service catalog is an API server extension which manages multiple service brokers, and each service broker is responsible for provisioning service instances. And you can use a so-called binding to combine your application with a service instance. We have a live demo. Okay, let's take a short look at the service catalog resource types. You have a cluster service broker or namespace service broker. And that is just a server running somewhere that offers various services. In this example, I've stick to a MySQL broker. So the MySQL service broker is responsible for managing MySQL. You have a cluster service class. That means you can have a MySQL database in this simple case. But it's possible, like we'll see in the AWS example, that the AWS service broker has multiple service classes to offer. You then have a cluster service plan, which is a specific type of your service instance. Imagine the following scenario. You have you need a MySQL database for development, so you have some with ephemeral storage, which costs nothing. And if you want to move into production, you can choose your production plan, which has persistent storage backed by an SSD, for example. So it's possible to have multiple versions of your offerings. You then have a service instance, which is just a single instantiation of a service or plan, so for example, a 100 megabyte MySQL database. And the last one is a so-called service binding, which is basically a plain Kubernetes secret, which tells your application how to connect to your running instance. Okay, let's talk about the most basic actions you can have in your service broker. The first one is provision. And it states, when the service broker receives a provision request from the platform, it must take whatever action is necessary to create a new resource. So this is the first step. Just to give you an example, which is written in Ansible, when we provision a new service, it's basically just a Helm install, but the customer doesn't know about it. So it just says in the UI, I want a MySQL database, and it gets provisioned using Helm. What is very cool about, we've learned in the last few months, it's not a good idea to run everything in your cluster, especially stateful sets. So it is even possible to deploy stuff outside your cluster and get the secret into Kubernetes and tell them how to connect your application running in Kubernetes to an instance of a database outside of your cluster. Deprovision, like the title suggests, it's the opposite of provision, so you just when the service broker receives a deprovision request, it must delete any resource it created during the provision, which often is just a Helm uninstall. So the most important feature for our use case is the bind operation. And as I've told you before, a binding is, at the end, simply put, an ordinary Kubernetes secret. So to give you an example what the user does, when you're developing microservices, you're trying a lot of new technologies. And as I've told you before, every artifact must be stored for at least 10 years. You need an artifact, you need a repository inside your binary storage. And all the user has to do is say, OK, let me bind to our Artifactory instance, and I want a Maven repository. Huh? This is all the user does. You can hide it behind a UI or some custom tooling. And what actually happens in the background is we're creating a new repository inside Artifactory using the REST API. We create a technical user with limited access and setting up audit log. We add the Artifactory permission target, set the permissions for the created user. And finally, we're returning a Kubernetes secret, which contains the username and the password, which then can be used by your application. And all you have to do is just say, I want to bind to Artifactory. So enough of the talking. We're going to show you now a demo.
OK, then let's have a look how it looks in reality. This is a local Minikube installation. Ah, we have this one. Yeah, I have a local Minikube installation and installed service catalog. And we have two brokers installed, the AWS broker and the automation broker. And we are using kubectl client and servicecat CLI to talk to the Kubernetes API server, and service catalog then does some action to fulfill our request. If you look at it, we have a controller manager and API server for service catalog running, the AWS service broker, and the Ansible service broker down here. And if you look at svcat get, you see the different entities mentioned earlier. Okay. So the demo is to provision a Gitti instance and bind it to Postgres. So we start by provisioning a Postgres instance. This is name of the instance. This is the class. It's an APB, an Ansible playbook bundle we created for this demo. And we just provision it with a default plan. We now look at the ports, the Ansible service broker down here spawns in a container, which shortly will be deploying a Postgres container up there. Next, we need a binding. Now we can look at it. So we have a new instance. Now it's ready. Now we need a binding. So we bind to the instance Gitti Postgres, and we call the binding Gitti Postgres binding. And as you can see, down there is another container creating. And this one is now creating a Postgres database in the user and the secret, of course. So now it's completed. If we get bindings, we see it's ready. And we should have a secret named Gitti Postgres binding. Now we provision the Gitti instance. And you can also pass parameters to the class. And we pass two start here. We provision an instance called Gitti of the class Gitti, the plan Postgres. There's also an SQLite plan, so you can see you can install different flavors of class. The database secret we created earlier, and an ingress host so we can talk to Gitti. Now we see the instance being created here, and we can should be ready every second. Yeah. Now it's ready. Now let's. So this is the Gitti instance created. Gitti is installing the database schema on the first run. So we see the host username password. Password is auto-generated. Is taken from the secret. Just have to put the right URL down here. And if we now have a look at the Postgres instance, we can see we have a new database called Gitti Postgres binding. And we can connect to it. And you can actually see the tables created by Gitti before. Okay. Now, the beauty of the service catalog is that you can talk to external, or you can provision external services as well. So, say we don't want data in the cluster, we want external Postgres database, so we set up an RDS on AWS with the AWS broker. But let's first deprovision our currently running Gitti instance. And there's another playbook running down there, and Gitti should be uninstalled in a few seconds. Yeah, that is terminating. If I deprovision the Postgres instance, it won't work because it's blocked by existing credentials. There's a binding left, and it won't be deprovisioned until we unbind from it. So we see the status of the binding is unbinding. There's a pod running here, which is dropping data. But I think it's completed. There it is. Now this is the deprovisioning now, because it is not blocked anymore. Now the deprovisioning takes place, and everything we've done is cleaned up. So now we provision a Postgres instance on AWS. We call it gtrds. This time the class is RDS PostgreSQL. This is we can have a look at the classes we have here in the cluster, and you see there are different AWS services and the two APBs we used. So let's provision AWS Postgres instance. I see some parameters here, VPC ID, and this one is publicly accessible for this demo. If you now look in AWS console, you see a new stack created. This is the Postgres instance. It takes about 10 minutes, so I switch to a prepared one. And here we have a ready ready Postgres instance, and I think it is this one. Yeah, can see in the AWS in the text that it's from container that is prepared. Yeah, now I do the same. Now I create a binding to this RDS. So we should have a secret. Yes, we have it. And if you look at the secret, you will see in the secret there's a username, password, and the address of the instance created. As Toby told, this service broker API is also it's also possible to have some nice UI. There's one project, Cube Apps, that can talk to the service broker. You can see the gtrds instance here with some with a binding, some status. Still in early stage. And you can also deploy the provision gitty by selecting gitty and the plans. This is the Postgres plan. Let's call it gitty RDS. And the database secret is gitty RDS binding. OK. I know this bug happens as a demo. It, in theory, it works, but Cube Apps is not really ready for prime time. So just let's do it with the CLI. So we call this gitty plan as a class. Okay. Same as before. Okay, let's wait a moment. And there's our Gitty, and if you look in the configuration here, you see we have a host on AWS and Amazon host. In fact, AWS bindings are the root, the master user of the database. The broker is not able to create real Postgres users at the moment. You could solve it with an own APB or just for the demo, it's okay, I think. And now we should have a Gitty instance running backed by RDS Postgres on AWS. Okay, LTE takes a second. Yeah, Cube Apps doesn't work, so I can't show this. And seems to be slow at the moment. Yeah, but it should work. In a few seconds, we should have a Gitty instance on AWS. And you can also deprovision services. They are getting deleted on AWS. Oh, there it is. OK, I think we don't have to look in the Postgres on AWS. It's there. Yeah, that's the demo of service catalog and brokers.
Okay, thanks for. Can you hear me? Okay, thank you for the demo. Just a quick summary. We've been using the Open Service Broker API for about 6 months, and the most important lessons learned is building a platform is hard, and if you have resources or money, you shouldn't do it by yourself, so instead you should focus on solving real-world problems and not deploying complex scenarios. Plain Helm is a very cool tool, as I've said before, but in our opinion, plain Helm is often not enough, so you can provision your tools with Helm, but then you have to connect them. And that's the most important part, that everything is connected together. It's also important to know not everything needs to run in your cluster just because it can. So especially when we're talking about stateful applications, and you need day two operations, which can be byte from Amazon or GCP or Azure. Unfortunately, the service catalog is not the most active special interest group, and the future is kind of unclear. We had a lot of talks at the KubeCon in Barcelona, and there's still some progress, but not as fast as we'd like to happen. And also, the community has decided it is focusing more on operators. So, yeah, I believe we need to re-evaluate the Open Service Broker API. The idea is quite cool because you have a standard set of APIs. Yes. That's all from our side. If you have any questions, feel free to ask. Yes.
Hello? Okay, so my question is, do I have to use or write Ansible to implement my own services?
No, this was just an example. Let's go back to the available service brokers. So what you've seen in the demo is the automation broker or Ansible service broker by Red Hat, and it's the most generic one because all it does is run Ansible. So you could either use one of the existing brokers. For example, from the AWS service broker, you have to write no code at all. You just use it. And if you want to use something else, you just have to implement the Open Service Broker API. So this is this were just these few operations we've seen here. Let me take a look. Provision, deprovision, bind, unbind. So you can write whatever tool you want.
Oh, okay, so I assume there is a library for programming languages I can use?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
And there are some. If you take a look at the Service Catalog homepage, there are some reference implementations. And
all right.
The automation broker, in fact, just calls an image with parameters, provision, deprovision, and some encoded JSON. Mm. So and you could run the automation broker with images that are not containing Ansible.
Yeah. All right. Good.
Any more questions? Okay. If you're interested in more details, we'll be behind at the QA web booth just behind you.